السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله وحده، وصلى الله وسلم على من لا نبي بعده وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. My brothers and sisters, cry as much as you want. It's the month of Ramadan. Shed as many tears as you wish. It is the month of shedding tears for the sake of Allah. No matter who you are, no matter what you've achieved in life, Allah Almighty has definitely made you in need of Him in such a way that you will have difficulty, you will have hardship, you will have situations whereby you are helpless, you will have needs where you know that without your Maker, I will not be able to achieve this. So therefore, cry as much as you want. Allah Almighty says, when He just speaks about the month of Ramadan in Surah Al-Baqarah, and He speaks about شَهْرُ رَمَضَانَ الَّذِي أُنزِلَ فِيهِ الْقُرْآنِ, the month of Ramadan in which the Quran was revealed. If you look at the verses after that, He speaks about calling out to Him. وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ أُجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِ إِذَا دَعَانِ فَلْيَسْتَجِيبُوا لِي وَلْيُؤْمِنُوا بِي لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْشُدُونَ. Allah is addressing the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. When my worshippers ask you about me, then I am near. It's amazing. He says, then I am near. فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ, so I am near. Now, if you look at the language used there, Allah did not even take the time to say, tell them that I am near. But rather He says, when my worshippers ask you about me, I am near. He didn't say, then tell them that I am near, although that would be included in the deeper meaning. The reason is Allah wants you to know that He is there faster than you can be there. Subhanallah. Before your need, Allah was already there. While you were in need, before you realized that you were in need, Allah is already there. He was already there. He is there. He will be there to solve your matter. And after your matter is solved, He is still there. That is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So people say the month of Ramadan, month of fasting. People say the month of Ramadan, month of the Quran. People say the month of Ramadan, month of charity. People say the month of Ramadan, month of calling out to Allah. People say the month of Ramadan, month of revelation. We know that. Month of connection with the Quran, month of Taraweeh, month of extra prayer, month of compassion. But I want to tell you, it is also the month of shedding tears. Cry for the sake of Allah. Cry for your needs. Call out to Him and weep. That is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Do you know that the categories of people who will be VIPs on the Day of Judgment, achieving the special shade that Allah Himself has given? One of them is رَجُلٌ ذَكَرَ اللَّهَ خَالِيًا فَفَاضَتْ عَيْنَاهُ. A person, obviously the term رَجُل means a man, but in this hadith it does not refer to a male as in masculine, it refers to a person. A person who remembers Allah on their own, and their eyes are filled with tears. Their eyes are filled with tears. If the filling of your eye with tears will make you a VIP on the Day of Judgment, what do you think would happen to you when those tears roll down your cheeks because of your need and you calling out to Allah? One of the ways of worshiping Allah Almighty is to call out to Him. مَنْ لَمْ يَسْأَلِ اللَّهَ يَغْضَبْ عَلَيْهِ. It's a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Whoever does not make dua to Allah, does not supplicate to Allah, does not call out to Allah for their needs, they earn the anger of Allah. Subhanallah Rabbil Alameen. It means Allah's kept these needs in you and He wants you to call out to Him. Like I said at the beginning, no matter who you are, you are desperately in need of the favor of your Lord. You are desperately in need of Allah to solve your matters, your problems, and to help you through life in your medical issues, your health issues, your financial issues, your social issues, and whatever else it may be. That is Allah. So when Allah speaks of the month of Ramadan and He mentions the verse of fasting, then He speaks of it being the month of the Quran. Thereafter He says, when my worshippers ask you about me, I am near. Ujibu da'wata da'i idha da'an. I respond to the caller whenever he calls me. Anyone calling out to Allah, He hears you. Don't doubt that. Right now, Allah hears us. If I say, even in my heart, if I don't know how to express myself and I'm calling out to Allah in my heart, oh Allah, help me in my situation, my condition. And not just me, but all those who are struggling, those who are going through more than I am going through, help them all. Do you know Allah hears you before you utter those words? He already knows what is in your heart. Many times I want things, I don't know how to say it. Not because it's embarrassing, but because perhaps linguistically, I would like something that I cannot communicate properly because of how massive it may be, or because of it having so many aspects to it, and I want all of that. Oh Allah, bless me with what you know I want. So when I say this, what happens? Allah already knows I know what you want. Did He hear me? He heard me before I uttered it. He already knew I was going to say it. He waited. It is better to say it beyond just the feeling of your heart, although Allah heard what was in your heart, like I said. Why? Because your lips are an organ of your body. They will bear witness when you've moved them. So some people say, when I remember Allah and I say Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah, Allahu Akbar, can I say it in my heart only? The answer is yes, you can, but there is a greater reward to include more organs. There is a greater reward. I can say in my mind, I can keep praising Allah, remember Allah, and it's in my mind and my heart. Am I going to be rewarded? Yes, indeed, you get a reward. It's a very big act of worship to remember Allah in your heart, to remember Allah within yourself. Dhakarani fi nafsi, a person who remembers Allah within his nafs. But it's better to include your tongue, your lips. So you move your lips. Now I'm moving my lips, but I haven't yet used my voice. Subhanallah. What does Allah say? Allah says, use more and more and more. And guess what? You get a bigger reward. And there is a greater chance that Allah will give you what you want. He's heard you and He knows. But now there are more organs that bear witness that you did something, and they will stand up for you on the day of judgment. When Allah says, الْيَوْمَ نَخْتِمُ عَلَىٰ أَفْوَاهِهِمْ وَتُكَلِّمُنَا أَيْدِيهِمْ وَتَشْهَدُ أَرْجُلُهُمْ بِمَا كَانُوا يَكْسِبُونَ. Surah Yasin, Allah says, on that day, we will seal their mouths and let the other organs do the bearing of the witness. So their hands will bear witness and their legs will bear witness against them or what they used to do. In the same way, your organs will bear witness for you. You said something, it's not gone to waste. And therefore, say good things. Because the opposite is true. If you were to utter bad things, Allah is so merciful. Do you know what He says? He says, when you thought of something bad, I still will not write it against you. When you thought of something good, it's already being written for you. But when you thought of something bad, it's not being written against you. Why? Because it was just a thought. I've tried to follow it through. The minute you start saying things, now it can be held against you. If you plan to do something bad and you do not do it, you are rewarded for having held back for the sake of Allah. But if you thought about something bad and it did not yet come into a plan, Allah says, we haven't written it against you or for you. We are holding. The minute you start saying, depending on what it is, say for example, bad words, abusive words, now that you've uttered, guess what? Your lips, your tongue, your voice will bear witness against you because you did something very bad against someone. So in the same way, the opposite, as I said, when you say something good, you remembered Allah, you used your voice, you encouraged someone else, perhaps you might have continued, you moved your tongue and your lips, more and more of these organs will bear witness for you. Now, I asked Allah, oh Allah, grant me. Now, you and I all have needs. This is the month of Ramadan. It's the month of asking favor. We want to make this Ramadan remarkable. How will I make it remarkable? I will make it remarkable by doing the best I can and achieving the most that I can. When we talk of achievement, many people think that, well, I want to achieve something. I'm going to cry throughout Ramadan and I'm going to ask Allah for what I want. That's a part of it. More important than that is when Allah asked you to do something when He did not need it. Rather, it was for your benefit. Did you do it? That's a question. I'm asking Allah, oh Allah, grant me. And Allah says, I will give you. But when I asked you to do something, you did not do it. Oh, we have a problem. You follow what I'm saying? If I want something from Allah, I'm crying to Allah, oh Allah, I'm desperate, I'm in need, and so on. Allah says, look, I'm not even desperate, nor am I in need. But I told you to do something. You knew that whenever you needed something, you had no one but me to come to. When I instructed you to do something, you just said, I'm not going to do it, and you moved on. But still, my mercy, I will give you. How's that? How's the mercy of Allah? Imagine the most merciful saying, I will give you. Let's get back to the dua. And while I'm talking, I want you to think of something you desperately want in life. You're young, perhaps you want to achieve something, perhaps you want to get to a certain point, perhaps you need to get married, perhaps you need to have children, perhaps you want to see those children grow and succeed, perhaps you want good health, perhaps you have a job, a dream job that you want to land, mashallah. Perhaps you have some income target that you have set. All of this, a lot of it that I've mentioned is material items of this world, but still, think of something. So now I'm asking Allah, oh Allah, every one of us who's thinking of whatever we're thinking of, grant it to us. Just say Ameen. Subhanallah. If that was a moment of acceptance of dua, we're set. May Allah grant us goodness. But there's one major problem. What if I'm asking for something I believe is really good for me, and in the knowledge of Allah, it's not good for me? Earlier, we read Salatul Taraweeh, and one of the verses of Suratul Kahf was how Allah Almighty taught Musa alayhi salam, the Prophet Moses, may peace be upon him, that there can be someone who knows something you don't know, and above all those with knowledge is the owner of all knowledge, who is Allah. He knows the past tense, the present tense, the future tense, and He knows that which will never happen, was never going to happen. If it were to have happened, how would it have happened? Allah knows that. So say you want something. You want to get out of a situation and go into a situation you believe is better for you. But Allah says, I know it's not good for you. I know it seems good. It's not good. This is where belief comes in. This is where your faith and your conviction in your Lord comes in. What do? You say, oh Allah, grant me this. It is what I want. It is what I'm asking you for. If it is better for me. Wow. If it is better for me. That's not easy. Because I've met so many people over the years who say, but I've been asking Allah and He doesn't give me. I say, what do you say? No, we learned from you and we learned from others that you ask Allah, if it is better for me, then give me. Well, then maybe that's not why He, meaning that's the reason why He's not giving it to you. No, but I asked Him for it. But He's still not giving me. But didn't you just say now that you told Him, oh Allah, if it is better for me, give it to me. Then if He has not given it to you, believe with conviction that it was not good for you. No matter how beautiful you think it would have been for you. That's faith. That's why we are here speaking about dua in the month of Ramadan. I want it to be a remarkable Ramadan, such that when I call out to Allah, and I told Him, when you know, and if you know in your knowledge of the future and in your supreme knowledge that this is not good for me, do not give it to me. Are you prepared to say that? When I've said that and I don't get something, I'm even happier to say, oh Allah, you saved me from something I desperately thought was good for me. the fact that I didn't get it and I called out to you. Number one, I believe you heard me. Number two, I believe you're the most merciful, the most kind, the most generous, the most loving, the most forgiving, the most honorable. That is you, O Allah. So number three, I firmly believe it costs you nothing to give me what I'm asking you. But number four, I believe that out of your love for me and your mercy and your knowledge, you decided and chose not to give it to me as a blessing. So I thank you, O my Lord. I thank you. Because ultimately, as a believer, you tell me what is the greatest success. I want to hear the answer. What is the greatest success for a believer? If I say, I'm a believer, or you say, you're a believer, and I say, what is the ultimate success that you can ever achieve? What is it? One word. Jannah, paradise. Paradise. Look, on earth, we may have good days, bad days. Again, I repeat, no matter who you are, there will be days when you are struggling, when you are suffering. There will be days when you are faced with anxiety and uncertainty. Why? Because Allah promises in the Quran, وَلَنَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ, we are going to test every single one of you. There will be anxiety, there will be fear, there will be loss of life around you, there will be something or the other. We will test all of you. So I want to say, if all of that brought me closer to my Maker, was it not a gift of the Almighty? Gift of the Almighty. So many people go through difficulty and challenge and hardship and struggles, and they have anxiety and so much more, and that brings them closer to Allah. Today they are so close to their Maker. They were not as close in the past. What just happened? Wasn't all that hardship a gift because Allah brought them close? And that's the reason why sometimes Allah does not take you out of what you think you need to get out of. Because the fear is, when I get out of it, I'm going to forget Him again. And I've seen this happening. You have people who come close to Allah, slowly. Look, I must pause for a moment and tell you, my brother, my sister, your journey is yours alone. Do not let someone make you feel like you are distant from Allah or you are not worthy, because you know your struggles. They don't. You know how far you've come. You know slowly but surely how you've developed. They don't. The world will say things. People will utter words. They will cut you up into the last of pieces because they don't know and they don't really care. But Allah knows. Allah watches you. And Allah sees your baby steps and appreciates them. That's why He says, whoever comes to me a handspan. Handspan meaning a little bit. I come to them a whole foot, much more. Whoever comes to me walking, I come to them rushing. That's a hadith of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. So keep on your baby steps. And Allah says, I will come to you rushing. You will feel my presence in your life. You will feel your life being touched with blessings and goodness. Why? Because you have an element of goodness within you for the sake of Allah. So your journey is yours alone, but as you develop and as you become closer, don't lose focus. Don't lose focus. The focus is paradise. In this world, the struggles are real. Everyone's. No matter who you are. But as I become closer to the day I'm going to be leaving this world, I will be a more content person, because now I know I'm no longer so fearful of the day I'm going to leave the world, because I know, what do I know? The Lord who's waiting for me is most merciful, most kind, most generous, most loving, most forgiving, most beneficent. Ooh, subhanallah, what an amazing Lord. Shaitan comes to you and I, do you know what his plan is? His plan is to make you doubt the Almighty. That's his plan. His plan is to make you doubt that Allah ever heard you. I told you moments ago, when you are calling out to your Lord, you cry. It's in your heart. Translate it onto your lips, your tongue, your voice, and so on. Let it come out. Let the tears be shed. Shaitan will make you feel, my Lord did not hear me. That's the first step. He makes you feel, my Lord did not hear me. You are wrong. He heard you and he knows. It's a matter of time. He wants you to cry for a little bit longer. Have you noticed something? Whenever we raise our hands to Allah, Allah says, when you raise your hands, especially those who are slightly older, those with gray hair and so on, Allah says, I feel shy to let this person return their hands without me having given them what they're asking for. That's Allah. So you raise your hands. Have you noticed something? I ask Allah, oh Allah, grant me this and grant me that. 9 times out of 10 or more, 99 times out of 100, as you put your hands down, you feel good about the fact that you asked. But it doesn't just come straight through the ceiling. Am I right? 99 times out of 100, it doesn't happen instantly. Why? Not because Allah cannot do it. Wallahi, He can cause the ceiling to break apart and it will drop down. He can. Obviously, you might laugh at me, but we believe in miracles, right? Hasn't happened maybe in our presence. But Allah can give it to you instantly. I think sometimes we might have had cases where we're just asking Allah and next thing, this thing is done, man. Subhanallah, you ask, oh Allah, grant me this, and you get a phone call as you're closing the dua and the person says, you just got this. You say, wow, my job. I just asked Allah. Jump back into sujood and prostration and thank Allah once again. But I want to tell you, 9 times out of 10 or more, it's not happening immediately because Allah wants you to come back and cry again and come back and ask again and come back and ask again. Why? He loves the way your heart is softened. You've become such a nice person. You quit a few of those sinful things you were, you know, you found difficult to quit. The fact that there's now a desperate need. So those things that you were finding so hard to leave, or things that you knew you had to do that you were finding difficult to do, you started doing them. And Allah says, hang on. I'm going to leave you in this situation for a while because look at you. You're so blessed, you're so lovely, you're so amazing. You've softened up to everyone and you've plugged in with us. If we're going to give you what you want right here, right now, you might just turn back and turn away and say, oh, thank you very much, goodbye, I'm gone. Hey, the last time we saw you praying and crying was when you had a need. Then what happened? Then your need was fulfilled. Now you said, goodbye. And you're no longer there. Allah says, wait. We're going to create another need. And a bigger one. Not because we don't like you. Because we love you. That's the true reason. Hence the hadith of the Prophet. He says, "Inna Allaha idha ahabba 'abdan ibtala." When Allah loves His slave, He puts another test in his life. He tests him again. Subhanallah. And another narration says, "Idhamul ajr ma'a idhamil ibtila." The greater the challenge and the test, the greater the reward. Because you know why? The bigger the problem, the more changes you make that you were supposed to make. Everyone knows what's right and wrong. You know what you're supposed to be doing and what you're not supposed to be doing. But life's challenges are such that I'm cruising through the beautiful world and I'm forgetting what I need to do. I'm not strong enough. I'll meet my friends and others and say, I'm not yet ready to do this. You're not yet ready to obey the instruction of Allah. Yeah, I'm a human being. I'm weak and so on. You know, we just heard the other day that as a human being, you're weak, you falter. You know, keep on taking those baby steps. Allah says, wait. We're going to make you leap just now. We're going to make you leap just now. By doing what? Suddenly, the doctor comes and tells you, you have been diagnosed with stage 4 cancer. And according to medicine, you don't have more than 4 weeks to live. What happened? Baby steps are irrelevant. My life changed. A few weeks ago, there was a certain uncle who was diagnosed cancer. May Allah grant him cure and all those who have any disease and sickness. Ameen. And so the family was thinking about whether they should tell him or not. You know, they've given him a short time to live, for example, and they've said, perhaps he doesn't have long, make him comfortable. That's what they say. And I addressed one of them and I said, my brother, this man has a right to know his results. He has a right to know his results. He has a right to know that he has cancer and what stage it's gotten to and what medicine is saying. Why? Because Allah's blessed him with some time to make peace with the one you're going to go back to. And you want to say to him, don't worry, everything will be okay. You're going to be fine. And poor man does not know that any minute I'm going to go. You have a right to know your results. Come on, I'm a human. If there's something wrong with me, you need to let me know. Listen, according to medicine, 4 weeks. How many have been given 4 weeks according to medicine, and it's been 4 years and 10 years, and they're probably sitting in our midst here? But wasn't there a day when, yes, it gave them a bit of a shock? What happened? Those baby steps were no longer baby steps. In one split second, I said, Astaghfirullah. Oh Allah, I have turned away from you throughout my life. I've done so many things that I'm not supposed to have done. Oh Allah, I seek your mercy. I would like a miracle to cure me. I would like your miracle. You are the owner of cure. You are the one who can grant cure without even a doctor. Grant me from your mercy and your miracle. That's what I want. That's what you want. All of us who are sick and ill, what do we want? We want to get better. Even an old person, 80, 90, if they get sick and ill, what do we say? May Allah grant you cure. But you got a good age. You lived until 80. The Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, lived until 63. You've clocked it way beyond that. But it's just normal. It's human to say, oh Allah, grant us cure. It's also a part of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But then what happens? Together with that, don't delay the preparation for the meeting with Allah, because that's what might just happen. And if it doesn't happen now, it's going to happen soon. It's like Allah telling you, we're taking you away in 4 weeks, and we're going to let you know 4 weeks in advance that you're coming. That's a gift of Allah. Imagine if all of us knew the date of death. Imagine if all of us knew the time of death. I reckon morning of the day of death, we'd say, right guys, leave everything, throw the bottles out, throw this out, throw that out, no more sin today, I'm going guys, salam alaikum everyone, and that's it. And I'm turning to Allah, and you're going to say, what time? Okay, 5 minutes past 12, you're going to start your salah, you're going to be in sujood at that moment. When Malakul Maut comes, suddenly, zoom, you've gone in sujood. Ooh, what a blessed death. What a blessed death. Allah has not kept it that way at all. Even if you are told 4 weeks, it's not true. It may or may not be. It could be before that, could be after that. Why? Because Allah knows you would fail the test to know the end result. People say, you know, predestiny, Allah already knows whether I'm going to heaven or hell. So what's the point of all of this? The point of all of this is you don't know. So the fact that you don't know, keep working hard. That's the simple answer. You don't know, I don't know. Do you know where you're going? No, I don't. So then work hard. But Allah knows. So what if Allah knows? So what if Allah knows? Allah's knowledge encompasses absolutely everything. Right now, He's given you capacities and powers. Use them and get closer to Him. Here we are, my brothers, my sisters. What an amazing month Allah's given us. Allah tells us, this is the month. The month to turn to me, the month to soften, the month to change, the month of compassion to reach out to others, the month of empathy, consider others, think about what people are going through before you open your mouth to talk to them. It's the month of Allah, the most blessed month of the entire year for Muslims. And it's a month where something should change in your life, something should change. And if you changed one thing every time Ramadan came back, and it keeps coming back again and again, and if you notice it's coming back sooner. I think when we were young, Ramadan used to come once a year. As we grew older, that year is crumpled, and it seems like just now then the other day was Ramadan, we're already back here. What happened? It's time being crumpled. That's it. It seems like it came twice this last year. But it didn't. Ramadan, before you know it, there's going to be another Ramadan. Some of us would have gone back to Allah, some will still be here. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us to meet again in His obedience. Have hope. Have hope in the mercy of Allah. It's the month of hope. In this month, Allah is literally distributing forgiveness every single night. Lillahi utaqa. Every single night, Allah has names of people He's granted freedom from hellfire. What is He watching? He's looking at your heart, your deeds, your worship, your compassion, the softness of the soul, your intention, your seriousness, and the way you're moving forward. And Allah says, you know what? For this person is paradise. It's okay. The problem is, I don't know. I want to know. Please let me know. I can't. I can't be told. If Allah had to tell you, for you is paradise, what would you do? Imagine if you knew you're going to paradise. What would you do? I thought about this because the companions of the Prophet, peace be upon him, were told by name, listen, you're from paradise. Think about it, if I was told that, I'm thinking for a moment, imagine someone, somehow, I wonder how, but if somehow you were told, listen, you're from Jannah, you're definitely going straight there. There are people known as Al-Ashara, Al-Mubashshirina Bil-Jannah. 10 of the companions of the Prophet, peace be upon him, who were told by name one after the other, you going to paradise, you going to paradise, you going to paradise. But there were many more than 10. There were those 313. That's a number that's very distinct in Islamic history, because that's the number of people who participated in the first major battle known as the Battle of Badr. How many were they? 313. Do you know what? One day there was a companion addressing another with a little bit of disrespect, and the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, says, leave him alone. He participated in the Battle of Badr. And what do you know about the people who participated in the Battle of Badr? Allah looked at their hearts and said, if'alu ma shi'tum fa inni qad ghafartu lakum. Do what you want, because I have forgiven you completely. You must be thinking, isn't that a crazy thing to say to someone? Do what you want, because I've forgiven you. For you and I, it's crazy, because our minds go to haram things that we can quickly get done. I'm going to paradise anyway. Now let me go and do this and do that and do that and do that. That's what happens to the human mind of today in many cases. But at the time of the companions, when they were told, you are forgiven, you're going to paradise, they started doing more deeds because they wanted to be thankful to Allah and they wanted to get a higher status in Jannah. So because of that, they kept on doing more deeds. One day, Aisha radiallahu anha saw the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, standing in prayer. And that used to happen often. But one day, when she noticed how his legs were swollen because of how long he was standing in prayer, she says, O messenger, you are the messenger. You are granted paradise. You are the highest. You are sinless and so on. And you are standing until your feet are swollen. She says that he responded to her and says, oh Aisha, afala akuna abdan shakura? Should I not be a slave who's thankful to Allah? I can stand all night here. Should I not be a slave who's thankful to Allah for the status that he has bestowed upon me? That's what happened at that time when they were told, you are from Jannah. So ultimately, I want paradise. This is the month of paradise. Oh Allah, grant me Jannah. Oh Allah, grant me Jannah. Oh Allah, grant me Jannah. You know, there is a hadith of the Prophet, peace be upon him. As tough as your life is, as tough as your life is, there's a narration of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. He says, when a person keeps asking Allah for paradise, paradise itself asks Allah to make that person come into it. Subhanallah. Imagine, oh Allah, grant me paradise. Oh Allah, grant me paradise. There comes a time when paradise says, oh Allah, grant this person entry into paradise. So keep asking Allah for paradise. Together with that, change a few things in your lives. I need to change a few in mine too. We all do on different levels. Change a few things. Start off with the small things, but start somewhere. Why do I say this? Make an intention. This is the month of Ramadan, month of purity, month of purification. If I'm doing 1,000 things that are wrong, and I say, oh Allah, I want to become a person who does nothing wrong, and I want to fulfill all my obligations, I'm going to start here, and I'm going to grow bit by bit. Help me, strengthen me. Give me the strength to do as much as I can. Allah will give you. Like I said, sometimes you might have to leap, because your life might, you know, come to sudden news that will change it. But if you are to do bit by bit and you die in the process, Allah will reward you as though you had already completed that process and purified yourself. Subhanallah. Why? Because all actions are judged by their underlying intentions. That's the reason. I give you one simpler example that you will understand. Imagine you want to memorize the Quran and say you are about 50 years old, 60 years old. And you know, at this stage, my memory is not that grand. I can't even remember a lot of things. And I want to memorize the Quran. I want to be resurrected among those who are Ahlul Quran. So I made a promise to Allah and I said, oh Allah, I'm going to learn a verse a week. What did I just say? A verse a week. Is that a lot? The kids will tell you that's nothing. Little children will say it's nothing. In the eyes of Allah, it's something. I'm going to learn one verse a week. And the number of verses that I will cover in the year, approximately 50. Maybe 2 weeks because of Eid, because of this, because of that. Let's say 52. It's going to take me a long time. But if you do it consistently every single week and you're growing and you're growing, if Allah gave you life sufficient to see the end, you would have completed it. But if Allah took you away prior to that end, Allah will write you and your name as a person who has memorized the Quran based on your intention. Allahu Akbar. Based on your intention. So are we all going to, inshallah, start memorizing a word a week? Okay, that's a bit on the low end. But inshallah, come on, we make a good intention. I have things I need to improve, inshallah. I was trying to draw up a list of these things some time back and I told myself there's quite a bit I need to get done. Imagine, it's such a big blessing that no one can see what another person needs to improve in their lives on their faces. Oh, we wouldn't even greet each other, I promise you. We wouldn't even greet each other. Imagine if you saw my face and you had to say, hey, this guy needs to change these 12,000 things. Gosh, man. And he's standing here talking to us. But Allah's blessing. Allah says, no, we only show people the beautiful thing. One of the du'as of the Prophet ﷺ, he used to call out to Allah by saying, Ya man dhahara al-jameela wa satara al-qabih. Oh, you who has made apparent that which is beautiful and you've covered that which is ugly. Those are qualities of Allah, man. Allah's the one who made apparent that which is beautiful and He's covered that which is not so grand. He's covered it in every sense of it. Subhanallah, Allah's given us adornment and beauty and we, mashallah, we see people, they don't know how much of muck we might be in terms of sin. And they don't know how desperately we're trying and we're struggling and we keep slipping every single time. Shaitan, as I said, makes you think and believe at the beginning that Allah did not hear you. And after that, if you get to a point where you've overcome that and you believe Allah heard me, He starts making you think that, but Allah does not love you enough to give you what you're asking for. That's another problem. And if you've overcome that and you begin to believe that Allah will give me what is better for me, there comes a time when Shaitan makes you doubt the mercy of Allah in totality. So he begins to say, listen, you sought forgiveness, but your sin was so bad and you went back and committed it again and you went back and committed it a third time. Allah will never forgive you, not you. Everybody else in this hall, but not you. That's Shaitan. That's the devil. Allah told us already He's going to do that. So why don't you understand? Before seeking the forgiveness of Allah, find out who is Allah and find out who is the devil. And find out how Allah operates and find out how the devil operates. The devil is there to instill hopelessness in you and Allah is there to instill hope in you. لا تقنطوا من رحمة الله إن الله يغفر الذنوب جميعا. Surah Az-Zumar. Allah says, oh my slaves who have transgressed against themselves, never, ever, ever lose hope in my mercy. Allah will forgive all your sins. That's Surah Az-Zumar. That's Allah talking. And what does Shaitan say? Shaitan says, ah, Allah's not going to have mercy on you. Not you. Not you. You went a little bit too far. You actually did something way beyond everybody else. It's not you. This verse doesn't even apply to you. What is Shaitan doing? The problem is believers are starting to listen to what the devil is saying and saying to themselves, I don't think Allah has forgiven me. How dare you think so low of Allah? How can you think so low of Allah? When He tells you, don't lose hope in my mercy, don't ever lose hope in my mercy. This is the month of mercy. It's the month of goodness. The mercy is descending while I'm speaking. Our hairs should be standing and we should be asking Allah, oh Allah, have mercy on me. I'm desperately in need of your mercy. And I know you're merciful and I know that you've heard what I feel and what I'm saying. Oh Allah, grant me the best of this world and the next. Ameen. He will give it to you. He will grant you. If not today, then tomorrow. There is a time frame. Wallahi, I want to tell you something. All of us, without exception. Where were you years back? And what was your condition and situation? Did you ever dream in the wildest of your dreams that you would be in such a beautiful condition today? Did you ever think, and if it's not you, if you're still young, think of your fathers or forefathers, your grandfather. Where were they? What were they doing? Could they even, for example, in many cases, in my case, could they even afford a lot of what you can afford today? And we're sitting and complaining. Wallahi, we're sitting like kings and queens and we're still complaining about Allah. Come on. That's why Ramadan is here. Allah tells you, don't eat, don't drink, don't engage in permissible intimacy with your spouse. Permissible meaning that which is permissible otherwise, like water and drink is permissible otherwise. Your own spouse, and Allah says, hold on, hold back. It's a month of discipline. Allah wants you to control because life is all about discipline. The happiest of people are those who discipline themselves. The most content of people on earth are not those who did whatever they wanted, not even one of them. The most content people on earth are those who disciplined themselves. They got up at a certain time, they worked hard, they respected everyone, they fulfilled rules and regulations, and they followed by the book. They are the happiest, the most content, in all honesty. Allah has given us that book. Discipline yourself. The rest of what you see on earth is all temporary enjoyment. It's not the paradise. It's something temporary, either 5 minutes, or 5 days, or a little bit more, or a little bit less. But it won't go beyond that. When you discipline, the fact that you held back for the sake of Allah, or you did something for the sake of Allah, the energy required for that will extend throughout your entire life in returns. So here's the month. This is the month. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us solve our problems. In a few moments, I would like to call on anyone from the public who would like to participate with us this evening to come and share one quick story in 59 seconds of how remarkable your Ramadan has been, or perhaps how your life was touched by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in terms of the things we mentioned this evening, the dua factor, the crying and the tears factor, and so on. Because the idea is many people are going through and have gone through so much of negativity, difficulty and challenge. And in a world where we would like to bring about hope that Allah has taught us, listening to how Allah has touched the lives of some would actually bring about a lot of comfort to the broken heart. So as we get ready, I think there is a microphone to my right for the men and one to my left for the women. And as I see the people queuing up, inshallah, we will start giving you an opportunity to speak. And don't worry, you can say things. The only thing you need to remember is it's not only recorded, but it's going to go far and wide by the will of Allah. So if you're a person who says, look, I'm very private, I don't want to talk, then don't speak. Then maybe, you know, you can perhaps share it with your own group of friends. But if you come up, it's a very good thing. I came up here today to talk to you in order for all of us to feel the beauty of Ramadan, to feel that we are really trying to do something. Look, every one of us, we've increased our prayer, we've increased our connection with Allah, we're trying our best to fast, to reach to the poor, we're trying to do as much goodness as we can. Is that not true? Is that not true what I just said? Well, in that case, we should be thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we are here to discuss that. And we are here to try and appreciate the favors of Allah upon us. Because indeed Allah is most merciful.